Hello everyone, welcome back. In this session, we first have Stefanos telling us about Ethereum's fee market reform of EIP 1559. Please.
Right. Thanks a lot for the introduction. Hello. We'll talk about Ethereum's fee market reform of APE 1559. Ethereum Improvement Proposal is the abbreviation. This is a joint work with Barnabé Monod from Ethereum Foundation and specifically from the Robust Incentives group. You can check on GitHub the content of that group. And two recent graduates from SUTD, Tsing Zhe Hum and Marcus Ko, and myself and our advisor, Georgios Pilloras at SUTD. So I will explain briefly how currently the transaction fee market works in Ethereum and what the improvement proposal 1559 is trying to accomplish, and some analysis that we have done. So the important entities and objects in the transaction market are the users who submit transactions to a common pool that is used by miners. Of course, the transactions is the important ob are the important objects because in each transaction requires some predefined gas, so some resource to be processed. And the miners, of course, who are the ones who are free to select which transactions to include in the block. To prioritize their transactions, users make bids when they submit a transaction in the form of a gas price. So they how much simply put, this is how much they are willing to pay for each unit of gas that the transaction requires. However, including a transaction in a block poses some risks. It increases the block size and hence also the propagation time of the block, which generates a risk for this block becoming stale and some other block making it first to the canonical chain. So miners undertake a risk whenever they include a transaction in the block. So miners so really need to include to choose which transactions to include and include only such transactions that have a high enough fee to cover their cost, their additional cost of processing this transaction, including the risk that we said. So let's instantiate everything in our mind with an example. A typical transaction requires 21K units of gas. A block size has 20 million units of gas, but this is not a fixed number. It may have other times it may have 10, or a target size may be 10, and so on. But let's say as a canonical example, we have this thing. So approximately 1,950 transactions per block. So one user may submit a transaction, a normal transaction, which requires 21K, and bid a price of 100 Gwei. Gwei is a subdivision of ETH per gas unit. Another user may submit the very same transaction, a very similar transaction, but simply bid four times that price. This is something that we observe in practice. So the first transaction generates a fee of approximately one USD for the miner who will include it. The second transaction generates a fee of six USD for the miner who will include the transaction. So all this, the whole mechanism resembles a generalized first price auction. So users with similar transactions but different valuations for the transactions or the time that they want to wait for the transaction to be processed, and make different bids for gas prices. And this is now a large number of transactions, let's say, larger than 1,000, is in a queue to be included in a K slots, in 1,000 slots that we have in each block. Okay, of course, it refers to units of gas, but this is how we should think about it. And typically, we have a number N much larger than K. So this is a generalized first price auction. Generalized means that we sell K slots, not just one item, K items to N people. So what are the problems with the current mechanism? First price auctions have very well-known problems. They create extreme volatile transaction fees, unnecessary transaction delays, because all this comes from the unnecessary guesswork for the right fee. So when you submit a transaction, you really don't know what is the right fee. And if you are in a hurry or if you are not in a hurry, you really don't know how much to bid for the fee. So here we take a random day, so it's nothing special about the day that we present here. And what we see in the graph here In the horizontal axis, we have the price ratio, so the maximum gas price over the minimum gas price that was paid within the same block. And here's the cumulative distribution function, and we see that 75%, so 25% of the blocks has a ratio of 12 units or more. So to make this to parse this with a realistic example, think of driving your car, paying $1 at some gas station, and in the very next gas station you pay $12 for the same liter of gas. So we see these fluctuations within the same blocks, and again the same in the same week we can see how the median gas price in Gwei fluctuates between days and within the same day. So we have here some periodic behavior. So it fluctuates from 100 to 400 Gwei. So this is a very undesirable behavior. Such large fluctuations in the price, and for no reason, because they just come from the guesswork of the people, it's really undesirable. So the proposed reform, that's how it works now. So let's go to the proposed reform, APE 1559, which is currently discussed by the put forward by the Ethereum community. So the idea is to set a target block load and a dynamic minimum gas price, which is called the base fee. So the base fee is at the core of this mechanism. The base fee will fluctuate between different blocks, and it will increase when blocks are too full. So to prevent, to scare people away, to price people away, and it will decrease when blocks are below the target block, so they are too empty, it will become lower to attract more users. So we see here just an example. We have a full block at time t. The mechanism takes as input this information. It's above the target load. The current target is set at half the block size. So remember, we had about 1,000 slots. That's somewhere 500 slots that we want to fill. And of course, this will lead to a decrease in the base fee of the next block. Of course, exactly the opposite in the opposite will happen. If we have an empty block at time t, we will increase the base fee. The base fee will take this information and will increase automatically to attract more people with lower valuation. So what are the parameters in this mechanism, and who decides what? First of all, the users, they make bids. The bids now comprise two parameters, the fee cap and the premium. The fee cap is the highest price that the user is willing to pay for a head transaction. So it's just a price similar to the one that we have now. But the premium, right. So, and the protocol, the premium is the maximum tip that a miner may receive from the transaction. All right, so the protocol specifies two parameters, the target load, which is currently set at half the block size, and the base fee, which is the dynamic parameter that we'll study in this work. And miners have one parameter, which is a marginal cost to include one more transaction. And of course, the transaction in the end may be included or not, depending on what the miners decide. Let's see some examples to understand these parameters in practice. So a user may set a fee cap of 10, and the premium of 2. The base fee, let's say, is at 6, and the miners have a marginal cost equal to 2 in any case. So in this case, the fee cap covers the total cost, which is 6 plus 2, and therefore the transaction will be included. In the second case, the premium of the bid is very low. No miner wants to include this transaction because they are going to get at most one way or whatever denomination we have here. So the transaction is not included. And in the second case, the transaction is not included while the premium covers the miner's cost. The fee cap that cannot cover the whole cost of the transaction, which is 9 plus 2. So the condition for inclusion is that the minimum of these two quantities exceed the miner's cost. And what we have here in the left side is the miner's tip, what the miner will receive from including the transaction, because the base fee is burned, it doesn't go to anybody. And so this is hopefully solves the confusion. Sometimes people think that the premium that you bid is exactly the tip that the miner gets. All right, so if the condition is met and the transaction is included by some miner, the user will pay the transaction fees. They will never exceed the fee cap. The base fee will be burned. So the base fee will be burned. It will, nobody will receive the base fee. And the miner tip, which is at most the premium set by the user or less, will be received by the miner. So that's how the proposal specifies now the transaction fees. It separates them to some burn quantity and some tip that you can give to the miner. So the, what are the goals of this proposal? It's to discover the price very quickly, the right price of the transaction fees quickly when demand changes. Of course, also when demand is stationary. This is the easy case. And to enforce price taking behavior so that which is transparent and efficient and which ensures next block inclusion for the users. What is not a goal of APE 1559, and sometimes people get confused, is it does not intend to lower the fees, but of course to lower the the variance of the fees within same blocks or in consecutive blocks for no reason. So to reduce all this guesswork about the right fee. And also it's not a goal to have constantly every time the same fee. So when we have a demand shock, so when we have suddenly very high demand, we expect the base fee to increase, but to quickly increase what we want, the desirable thing is to see that the base fee quickly increases and matches the changing demand. The goal of this work, because there are also different works now on APE 1559, studying different aspects of the mechanism, is to study the dynamics of the base fee as a dynamical system, both theoretically, if we can put our hands on some theoretical results, and of course experimentally to study different scenarios, how the base fee behaves under different scenarios. So here, this is the main slide, I would say, of the presentation, because here is what we see is the equation that we are gonna study, is base fee dynamic adjustment. So it's the exact formula. Let's see what all parameters are here about. So any subsequent formula will be based on this one. So we have that the base fee in block sub t plus one is equal to the previous base fee, so b sub t times one here, plus an adjustment term. Okay, let's focus on this term now. This term has an adjustment parameter or step size. We can think of this as 1/8 or 12.5%. So this is the current parameter that's put forward here. This is calibrated. So the step size changes by this term, by this fraction. So this fraction is dominated by the target, which is equal to the block size, the half block size. And here we have the actual number of people that get in the block, in block at high T. Given that the base fee was equal to t. So if you remember some two, three slides before, we had a figure showing how transactions get included in the blocks. So if you meet exactly the target to get some intuition, this will be zero and the base fee will remain the same. If you have a very large inclusion of transactions at time t, this will be positive. This will increase, this will give a positive term here and will increase the base fee. If you have less than the target, you will have a lower, this will be negative and this will decrease the base fee. Now, this term here, the people that get included in the block, given the base fee at this time, depend on two random on two sources of randomness. The first is the how people arrive placing the so what is the demand for transactions, and the second is what is the valuation of these people that come to transact with the blockchain. Some people may have a very large valuation and they may not be priced away, may submit very high bids. Or people may have very low valuations and bid below the do not accept this base fee that they see in the previous block. So to get a very concrete point-wise convergence of the base fee is quite impossible because we have, at least in theory, annoying edge cases. So some preliminary results, the base fee sequence forms a stochastic process, all right, because we have here, as we said here, this term is random. And has also the Markov property, so it only depends on the previous state and nothing before that. However, formal proofs of convergence are difficult due to edge cases. For example, here we see such an example. which is interesting in theory, but maybe not in practice. So here all users have similar valuations. Okay, this can be also a practical assumption. And what happens is that the base fee jumps from below to above this common valuation. So in one block, it prices, it includes everybody. In the next block, it prices everybody out. In the next block, it includes everybody in. And then prices, yeah, until it includes everybody in, prices everybody out, and so on. So we can have a very, very abrupt behavior. Of course, in reality, valuations are distributed evenly. And so on, and so you cannot observe this in practice. But theoretically, you cannot get very easy your hands on some convergence proof. So point-wise, convergence is not possible. What about convergence in expectation? So let's make a working assumption for now that block size is unlimited to make things a bit more intuitive, and we will relax this assumption later. Then we have a sequence of conditional expectations. Where here we take everything that is random has been instantiated to the mean. And yes, here we can derive a good candidate for where this stochastic process should converge, at least in expectation. Of course, this is not a martingale, so I mean, this does not increase or decrease all the time, or is it not a super martingale or sub martingale, or not even a martingale, so we cannot have easy convergence properties here as well. But we get a candidate, which is the term exactly that solves this, makes all this whole term equal to zero, so that the expectation of the next term is at least equal to the expectation of the previous term. And so here, well, many difficulties actually. We get some result if we relax even more the assumptions. So if we consider a deterministic process, let's forget where we came from here, and let's assume that we are given this deterministic process. And assume also, yeah, we forget the story about block sizes and about the expectations, then this deterministic process indeed converges to some neighborhood of P star, of the good candidate that we found before. This is observed here, this behavior is observed here, so we are in a neighborhood of the stationary level. But of course, this can have weird implications in the inclusion rate. If we have a very weird distribution here, which is not actual in practice, but which prevents theoretical proofs. So here, this slide also, I think, is the last technical slide. So sorry about that. So it simply says that we've all the assumptions that we've made before, even if we relax them, so the block size, etc. They give us, of course, some minimum in this case, and say that, again, the deterministic system, if we forget where we came from and just define this thing as this deterministic system, is attracted, again, to a neighborhood of B star. Of course, here, the only change is that we need a minimum between the good candidate and the block size. It's the only difference. That's the theoretical guarantees that we have. So in the remaining time, let's see some simulations in this environment that we due to the robust incentive groups, robust incentive group. All right. So first of all, with non-strategic users. So here we have arrivals with constant rate, and everybody pays the same price. So everybody pays their valuation, and just a fixed premium to the miners. So what we see here is that the payoff for the users is the value that they get, the valuation that they have, minus the waiting cost, the time that they wait to be included, minus the transaction fee that they pay. So here's the blue line is the base fee, what we are interested in. And of course, the average tip, which remains very low. What we see here, we see a spike in the beginning. So this is here, as we have a low base fee, people really want to get in, they submit the transactions, but they cannot be processed because the blocks are here full. So the base fee increases until it prices out everybody, and then it decreases to the stationary level quite quickly and remains there as long as the demand is the same. Let's keep this about rationality, which is quite maybe not too easy to explain right now. Okay, let's go to non-strategic users. Let's see what happens when we have demand shocks. So if we have a different demand here, so suddenly the demand changes at some point, This is exactly the previous figure, but with a shock here. And we see again what happens, a similar behavior. The base fee is too low to accommodate this fee. It quickly increases, very quickly captures the new demand level. It prices out, raises to a level that prices out every user until it can process the transactions in the pool. And then fast stabilizes at the candidate level that we found before. Of course, we can also relax the assumption of users being non-strategic. So we can have strategic users who bid the minimum premium plus some increments in the previous block to overbid other users when blocks are full. So particularly here in the beginning. And that's exactly what we see here, the yellow line at the bottom. It recovers the typical behavior that we see now, where users simply try to outbid each other. And so the premium really decides who gets in. The interesting thing about this simulation is that after some point, after the base fee spikes here and stabilizes, the base fee does not determine the premium, the tip to the miner does not determine anymore who gets included. Really, who gets included is determined by the base fee. We can see it even more clearly. Okay, maybe not so clearly, but I will explain how this graph. Maybe here. So here we have the inclusion rates of all people. So the blue line are the strategic users. The green line is the total users, and the other one, the orange here, is the non-strategic users. So we see in the beginning that only strategic users are included in the blocks. The blue line is equal. There are zero non-strategic users because the outbidding the others with a higher premium is exactly what makes what is the criterion to be included. But as the base fee increases, only users the valuation of the transaction is what determines who will get included or not. So everybody who has a high valuation will get included. Then here the large fluctuations are until the base fee empties the backlog in the transaction pool. And then after that, we see interestingly that strategic and non-strategic users are included in the same ratio. So of course here the simulation, non-strategic and strategic are spawned at the same rate, but again, they are included in the same rate. So this is the desirable result, meaning that the base fee decides who gets in. So the valuation that you have for your transaction and not your strategic behavior. Okay, this is a very similar slide. It simply explains the valuation of the people that get in. Again, here we see that when the base fee increases, people only with high valuations, high enough, higher than the base fee will get in, and not people who are strategic or not, depending on what they bid. So, what are the open questions and current work? There are a lot of open questions. I mean, A1559 is currently developed and put forward. So from our perspective here, from the group that we're working on it, is to determine the mode of convergence to study even more the dynamic update rule, what happens with this step size, etc. Of course, if we cannot get our hands on analytic results, continue to study different scenarios, but already we get promising results in the simulation. And other groups are studying the transition period between legacy transactions and A1559 transactions, or a mechanism to optimize the way that you bid, which simply increases your bid as you wait and accounts for your waiting costs, etc. But there are also many other things that are currently open about this proposal. It's a very interesting topic. And so you can find all code and notebooks open sourced in this library in GitHub, also from the Robust Incentives Group website. So yeah, I would like to thank you. Thanks a lot for your attention. That's it from me.
Thanks. Second question got to me is that people wonder if you can elaborate on the edge case that made it difficult for the theoretical proof of the convergence.
All right, that's a very good question. So that's exactly where we're working on. So the edge case here prevents pointwise convergence. So we see that the base fee goes to some neighborhood. So what happens? Think of everybody having 100 USD valuation. The base fee will go to 101. So from 99, it will include everybody. So the block will be full. So the base fee has to adjust according to this formula to become larger. It will become larger because this is here a bit large. So because everybody got in, it will become a bit larger. It will go to 101. It will price everybody out and then go back to 99, back to 101. And so we'll have, because we will have here a big step size. So we cannot, the idea is here that if you have a big step size, you cannot have convergence. So as is designed right now, we have a fixed term here. And the idea is that when this becomes ideal, so this cl goes close to the target, which is this one, this will become almost zero and we have very small fluctuations. And this is true in the actual case where we have continuous valuations and a lot of people come and are distributed in some interval. But if we want to break this theoretically, we just have this edge case. So this makes things wrong for the pointwise convergence, but still we cannot prove also in convergence in expectation, which should be possible, but for some reason, yeah, in expectations here, we see, for example, the expectation, the average, if we average all these values here, indeed they are very close to some value. But why we cannot now prove it, I think it's some technical difficulty, probably. Let's hope we can do it. Hope this
Okay, you don't think that it prevents it. It's just there needs to be more work in the future.
Right, I think, yeah, hopefully with more work, it will come out some convergence result here. Because we see this behavior in the simulation, also in the other simulations that I present here. So we see some convergence. So we really need to determine the right mode of convergence and say in expectation or weakly, yeah, something like that.
Okay, and a bit clarification. When you say that the block size is unlimited, they have T. T is not a block size. T is workload cap.
Ah, right. So yeah, the block size is yeah, how much there is a gas limit and block size is limited. So we just did an unlimited here to just avoid the minimum and this term and the inequality. So it's very similar when we did. Yeah, so the block size we can think of in gas units and the load is also in gas units.
I would just want to make sure that when you say that block size is unlimited, T itself is still limited, otherwise the formula would be problematic.
Ah, right. I understand. Yeah, so because T here appears here. Right. Yeah, the idea is here that we don't. Right, maybe it's the expression is not correct. So what I mean here is you don't have to worry whether this term is larger than the you can accommodate so many transactions or not. So we keep the target at this level. Yeah, but whether you can accommodate so many transactions or not, right?
Okay, makes sense. We should leave other questions to the Q&A session if you will still be here.
Okay, yes, of course I will.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. Thanks a lot.
The next speaker, please turn on your camera.